Eco-communities, COVID-19, and other potential pandemics. One Community Weekly Progress Update, number 367.
One Community is a 501c3 nonprofit organization. We are creating open source and free shared blueprints and resources, tools and tutorials, and do-it-yourself instructions for highest good living. Creating solution models that create additional solution-creating models in the service of all life on this planet.
My name is Jay Sable. I'm the executive director of the One Community 501c3 nonprofit organization. One Community is bringing together people with a consciousness and the desire for the highest good of all life on this planet to build sustainable and self-replicating teacher demonstration hubs as a pathway to global sustainability. This is our weekly progress update, April 5th, 2020 edition. And today's topic is eco-communities, COVID-19, and other potential pandemics, which is a pretty heavy topic. So this video might be a little bit longer than our usual videos because I really want to cover how we envision eco-communities like One Community being able to address preparation for pandemics, mitigation of pandemics, containment of pandemics, and recovery of pandemics. Like, how would life be different in communities compared to the way that people are dealing with this tragedy right now? And I want to say that for anybody that's lost somebody, the sorrow and the sadness of this, or people that are being affected by this in your lives right now, our hearts go out to you. And so with that said, you know, how could things be different with eco-communities, COVID-19, other potential pandemics? And to start with, I want to talk about preparation. Like, from a One Community standpoint, we think that community models like what we're creating, the open source tools, tutorials, resources, tutorials that we're designing to build teacher demonstration hubs that demonstrate radical sustainability, covering all aspects of sustainability, physical aspects, which are food, energy, and housing, and the emotional aspects, which we've identified as fulfilled living practices, highest good approaches to economics, highest good approaches to education, and true earth stewardship, putting all those things together, we can create an environment that is better prepared for pretty much any disaster. It's better prepared for a lot of different reasons. Number one, because it's mostly self-sustainable. To be able to grow your own food, to be able to produce your own energy on site, to be able to handle your own education program, and to be able to operate that all within a community environment gives you the ability to continue to operate in a situation like this if you are prepared enough to keep the situation from becoming a part of the community. And we think the communities are more prepared, just like some states were more prepared in the United States by taking action sooner, you know, and other communities within the United States, like cities and stuff, have isolated themselves better. For those who practiced the recommendations that have been put out there the most comprehensively, the results are maximally beneficial. And for people that are washing their hands, you know, all the time, that are people are taking seriously physical distancing, all of these things make a difference. And so from a preparation standpoint, within the community model, eco communities looking at COVID-19 and other potential pandemics, the preparation aspect is making sure that COVID-19 wouldn't come into an environment like that, like ours. And we see that we would have the ability to do that better than other communities, because it only really takes one person taking something very seriously to be able to bring it up to the attention of the entire community and for the community to collectively and cooperatively take action on that, right? So there's lots of people that took this seriously in our country, and there's lots of people that didn't take this seriously. And those that took it seriously, that self-isolated right away, have protected themselves. Like, if you're really self-isolating, you pretty much can guarantee that you're protected. You know, if you're really following everything that you should and have been doing it from the first notion that this could become a problem, then that creates safety. And so we see that from a preparation perspective, that's how One Community, eco-communities in general, can better address COVID-19 and other potential pandemics. Now let's talk about mitigation. In this case, imagine that it's already got into a community, because one of the concerns that a lot of people have is like, well, in a community environment, you guys are all close together, you guys are eating together, you're working together. Like, isn't that a breeding ground? Isn't that the worst case scenario? And my response to that would be, well, assuming that preparation failed, you know, assuming that nobody was paying attention to what was going on in China when this really was starting to blow up over there and saying, hey, we might want to take actions, and that it came into the community environment. Well, once again, just like any community is taking it seriously in the United States, we can, as an organization, because we know each other, because we're cooperating and collaborating and working together, our ability to address the problem internally is better than people trying to address it individually. Meaning that we have the ability, we will have the ability to, you know, make the food that's necessary for people that might be contaminated, that might have come down with or contracted it, to be able to self-isolate and for us to be able to bring them food, for us to be able to meet their needs without them having to go out and expose themselves to other people. If a community like ours wanted to do a complete lockdown and have everybody to guarantee that we didn't have anything within our environment, we could do a two-week lockdown pretty easily just by assigning the small group of people that would need to be able to make the food and do the things to keep us comfortable to do that. You know, and once again, if we're going out for shopping and all those different things, we can have one or two people do that for a group of 100 instead of, and we can and having stocks of food on supply because we're growing our food and anything that we can't grow because we're already buying it in bulk, our preparedness for any type of natural disaster, pandemics, things like that, is going to be much, much higher in an eco-community type environment like what we're creating than what it is in the traditional environment. Same thing like toilet paper, people are battling for toilet paper and hand sanitizer, like all those things would be on hand in bulk in an environment like ours because we need to keep them on hand because we have so many people that we're already working with. You know, and somebody's job is specifically to make sure that those things are on hand. And when you see something like this coming, our ability to stock up for things like that is much, much better as well, because we can collaborate and cooperate and work as a group to achieve that. Same thing if it were about testing. You know, if we knew something like that, this was coming, our ability to mobilize resources to get testing internally, to be able to test people if we needed to, all of those things, in our opinion, would be better than in a traditional environment. And if it came into that environment, our ability to isolate the people that need to be isolated and to be able to monitor anybody that we think might have been exposed, to be able to see it, and in worst case scenario, if everybody, if we're like, wow, we might have all been exposed, to basically say, hey, this is a small group of people that's going to handle the basic functions of our living environment, like producing cooking food, making food, and providing that for everybody, we could easily organize as a group. Because we're stronger in numbers, because we work better in cooperation and collaboration to say, okay, these are the people responsible for these tasks, and we can isolate different groups to manage everything and keep everything running. So if something did become a problem, it would just be within this contained group. You know, these people would be preparing food. These people would be responsible for, you know, washing clothes and those kinds of things and picking that up. And so the rest of us could self-isolate in our homes and in our environments. And the community environment being as it is so open, there wouldn't be limitations on being able to go outside and being able to spend time in nature and being able to do other things because we have so much space to be able to do that, to maintain the distancing if that was something that needed to be done because the situation was already so bad internally. So that's the idea of mitigation, of being able to limit the spread within the environment if the environment became contaminated with something like COVID-19. How we would be able to handle that better, and from a highest good approach, how we would be able to support each other in a situation if it became a problem. And that also covers containment. You know, the idea is like, okay, some people are infected. Like, how do we help and support them the most while allowing them to be isolated so that it can pass through and run its course? You know, what as a group, right now, in small families, there's only two or three people. You know, in a group of 100 people or 200 people, or as one community will grow to be more than hundreds of people, you know, your ability to say, okay, let's break up into small groups and task forces to help different segments of the population, to help people that are in isolation, would be much, much easier. You have the resources around you. And so, and same, like I said, testing, if you can do testing, then we would have the resources to be able to access those tests more easily and to leverage those resources much more available than individuals can do or even small families would allow us to test and say, hey, these are people that have already gotten this so they don't have to worry about it, or these are the people that we need to protect the most because they're elderly or because they have health problems. Our ability to work cooperatively and collaboratively as a group for the highest good of our community and the surrounding communities is much, much better in that type of environment. And then last but not least is recovery. You know, the idea of like, okay, if somebody came down and was really, really ill and had to go to the hospital, or if somebody, you know, or if a large group of people, even if a large percentage of the community was affected, you know, our ability to recover financially, our ability to recover from a health perspective and from a helping each other perspective is obviously going to be much greater with a group of people working together to take care of each other. You know, you got 100 people, even if 30% of the population were to come down with something like this, the other 70% is there to help out. You know, and so with more people that are there saying, how can we take care of the people that need the help the most? You know, how can we address the things that need being addressed the most? You know, how can we provide the best food? How can we recover from this as quickly as possible? A bigger group of people working together on that task are obviously going to be more successful. You know, so from our perspective, eco-communities and COVID-19, other potential pandemics, like this is a solution to that problem. It's a better solution than what we've got right now. It's the ability for people to better take care of each other, to better help each other, and to make a difference in each other's lives in a way that makes us safer, that keeps us healthier, and allows us to be more helpful to each other, and to make the situation like what we're all going through right now with self-isolation so much better. You know, to be able to work together with 100 people and say, okay, this is a situation, we need to self-isolate. What's the best way for us to address this? What's the best way for us to make this really work? And let's initiate and institute policies right now that everybody's washing their hands. Let's create a reward system for remembering what that is. And let's create a way to constantly monitor each other and help each other to do this. You know, let's sterilize our environment and keep everything safe. Let's self-isolate for 2 weeks. Really take this seriously so that we know that our environment is completely clean. And then we don't have to worry about this problem. That's what we're capable of doing in eco-communities with something like COVID-19 and other potential pandemics. So we see it as a lot better than the options that are out there. And we are open sourcing and free sharing these models because we want to create these models in a way that other people can replicate around the world and work in cooperation and collaboration to address challenges like these, natural disasters, and much, much bigger problems, ongoing generational problems like homelessness and starvation and lack of energy infrastructure and things like this, and better education and addressing social injustice and inequality. All of these things simultaneously we're working on addressing with One Community models and building a global cooperative and a global collaborative to do that. Because we see our preparation, our mitigation, our containment, and our recovery as better within these environments than the way that people are doing it right now. And we want to share that and evolve and improve that just like everything else. So this is what we're up to. Stick around for a couple more minutes to see like the overview. I didn't really talk a lot about our project this time, but everything in the background here has to do with this. So stick around, watch the overviews of each of the components of our project, learn a little bit more. And thanks for listening. Till next week, we will, of course, keep on keeping on. Thanks.
The One Community approach to highest good housing is eco-artistic home building that is affordable, sustainable, do-it-yourself duplicable, resource and space efficient, and consists of 7 different sustainably constructed village models. One Community is also creating an open source duplicable city center. It is designed to be LEED Platinum certified, provide 12 guest rooms, dining for over 150 people, and laundry and recreation space for over 300 people, all while saving money, time, space, and resources. One Community's approach to highest good food is duplicable almost anywhere, scalable for different needs, more biodiverse and nutritious, part of forwarding a global open-source botanical garden collaborative, and includes 9 different free, shared, and duplicable growing environments.
The next component is highest good education. This component is complete and pretty much ready to launch once we're on the property.
One Community's approach to highest good education is designed for all age groups, adaptable to any schooling environment, inspiring and fun for all participants, includes national standards, all subjects, lesson plans, teaching strategies, learning strategies and tools, classroom design, and more. The One Community approach to highest good society is globally focused, individually enriching, cooperative and collaborative, includes a highest good network and application, 4 different economic models, and combines fulfilled living and true earth stewardship for the benefit of all people and all life on this planet.